Okay. In today's class, let us understand with something called constructor, Java constructor. Constructor. Okay. Just give me a last confirmation from your end that you are able to hear me properly and all are able to see the screen as well.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. Thank you. Sharona, thank you. Let us understand what is the meaning of constructor in Java. Okay. As the name itself indicates, the constructor helps us to construct something. Okay. I'll repeat once again. The constructor helps us to construct something. That's the meaning of a realistic meaning of the constructor. With respect to program, okay. Let's say I just write a program, a class called as dog class, okay, and I keep some properties, string, color of the dog, then string name of the dog, and then int age of the dog, okay. Now I close this. This is a simple class. I think now you are able to see this properly. It's a simple class called dog class with few of the states. This is called state, or it's also called as, it's called as state, or it's also called as variables. States are variables. Now somewhere I write a code to create an object. How do I create an object? Dog d equal to new dog. Dog d equal to new dog. Here few things are there. This is class name. This is called a reference. This is a new keyword to create a new object, and this one. This is called the constructor. Okay, so I'll just repeat all these things. The dog is the class name. Okay, and then the D is a reference. It's also called as object reference or just the reference. New is the keyword. New is the keyword that we use, and this is called constructor. This is called constructor. Okay. So whenever a constructor is called by using a new keyword, then an object is created. Okay. So what is the meaning? If you closely observe this, this is the class name. Whatever I'm underlining in green color, this is the class name. This is also the class name, correct? But this is, the name looks like the class name, but it has something called, see, this is class name, but it is not just the class name. There's a parenthesis included here. So whenever a class name along with the parenthesis, then you can call it as a constructor. So it is very easy to identify the constructor of which class. This is the constructor of the class called dog class. So what is the meaning? Every class, whenever we write, every class has by default one constructor. If you please observe this class, here you are not able to see any constructor. You see just a class, class name, and along with some states. We don't have any constructor here. But still, whenever, the moment we write a class, any class, it can be any class, okay, I just write a class called as pen. This is a class, correct? So this class is an empty class, but still by default there will be one constructor. And who supplies this constructor? The compiler. The Java compiler supplies one default constructor. One default constructor. And remember, the constructor name must always be as the class name. Dog class has dog constructor, pen class has pen constructor. Okay, and the constructor of one class cannot be present in other class. The meaning, I cannot take this dog class constructor and add it into the pen class. It is not possible. Okay, so what is a bottom line understanding of this concept? Constructor is the one which helps us to construct an object, and every class, whenever we write, by default it has one constructor, and we call that constructor as default constructor. Okay, and the class name and the constructor name must be same, and the class and the constructor of a class must be present in the same class. And whenever a constructor is called by using a new keyword, then an object is created by JVM. It is something like this. Let's say there is a home. Okay, your mom is present inside home. Now you go to the home. Now you press the calling bell. Whenever you press the calling bell does not come and open the door. Correct? Instead, calling bell is an indication to the person who is present inside the house, so that this person comes and opens the door. Correct? So in the same way, the constructor itself does not create any object, but it is an indication for the JVM to create an object. What is the meaning? Let's say there is a heap memory. This memory is called heap memory, and in our previous classes we have already understood that all objects are created by JVM and objects are created in heap memory. Correct? So now, whenever I write a class, any class called pen, just an example of pen class, and whenever I create an object, it is new is the keyword and pen. This time it is not a class, instead it is a constructor. So whenever any constructor is called by using a new keyword, it's like you are pressing the calling bell. So constructor will not go and create an object in the heap memory. So this is an instruction for your JVM, Java Virtual Machine. So JVM creates an object inside the heap memory. But you have to instruct the JVM that, please JVM, create one object for me. How are we going to do that? By calling the constructor with the new keyword. Clear? So that is how a constructor is used. So at the bottom line, you can just say constructor is used for creating an object. So a new object called pen is created in the heap memory with some memory location. Let's say 1284 is the memory location. Class name is pen. So in the heap memory, the object is created. If I use once again new pen, obviously one more object is created in the heap memory. So the meaning is this: a constructor can be called any number of times. And this is the constructor of which class? Pen class. Just observe this. In this is an empty class. There is no constructor. When there is no constructor written by a developer or programmer in a class, or in the other way, when the class does not have any constructor, then compiler supplies one default constructor. The default constructor looks like this: class name, empty parenthesis, open, close. This is called default constructor. This is called default constructor. who supplies this? Compiler supplies this. Okay, with the help of this we can create an object. Okay, now remember, the constructor must always be called by using a new keyword. You cannot simply call this constructor pen. No, you should respect the constructor. Okay, constructor, remember, cannot be just called by the name. It must be called. There are three different ways of calling a constructor. Out of that, today I will teach you only one way of calling the constructor. That is, the constructor can be called by using the new keyword. There are two more ways of calling constructor. That is, by using something called super. Another one is something called this. Okay, these two things, this is not the way, I mean, these two things I'll teach in the future, once I probably in next class when I teach something called inheritance. Okay, as of now let us defer it. Okay, fine. So till now, any questions? Any questions for anyone? Fine, we'll continue the session. Is it the only purpose of constructor? Just now we discussed that it is used for object creation. Is there any other usage of this constructor? Yes, right, there are two types of constructors. One is something called, just now we have seen, that is called default constructor. Option number, that's one type of constructor, that is called default constructor. The second one is called as custom constructor. Second one is called as custom constructor. So one is default constructor, which we have already seen this. Another one is called custom constructor. Okay, let us understand these two things and what is the purpose of custom constructor. So the meaning of default constructor is, whenever we write a class with some variables and with some methods, but I don't explicitly write any constructor in this class. I just write a class with some variables, some methods, any numbers. Then by default, a constructor is supplied to this by the compiler, and that constructor is called as default constructor. In another way, the constructor which is supplied to a class automatically by the compiler is called as default constructor. So, I mean, whenever we write any class, you get a constructor, that is called default constructor. Then second one, custom constructor. The constructor which is written by the program creator, that is whoever it is. If you are creating a class and if you write constructor in a class, then it is called custom constructor. So two questions may arise. First thing, when default constructor is already supplied by Java compiler, what is the reason for us to write our own constructor? Why do I need to write our own constructor, or why do we need to write custom constructor? Correct. So in a class, whenever we write our own custom constructor, then default constructor is not supplied by compiler. Remember this, whenever I write a class, constructor must be present in this class. What compiler does is, compiler comes into picture only at the time of compilation. And when are we going to compile this? Once my program completes, then I'm going to compile this Java program. Correct. Now you have written a class, some class, okay, pen class. Now imagine I have written my own constructor. Can I call this as a custom constructor? I write my own constructor, I call it as custom constructor. Then I'm going to compile this Java program either in Eclipse or through command prompt. Whenever I compile that time I compile only by using the help of compiler. The compiler looks into this program. Oh, this is already one custom constructor is present. Hence the compiler does not supply any constructor. That is, the default constructor is not supplied to this class. Clear? So we need to remember this very clearly. In a class, you can either have custom constructor or you can have the default constructor. Both custom as well as default cannot be present in a class. This is option number one. Option number two, let's say I have not written any constructor, I have simply written a class. Simply written a class, and then now I'm going to compile. I write some variables, methods, some logic I write, but I don't write any constructor. Now I'm going to compile this Java program. Then at the time of compiling, the compiler observes, okay, there is no custom constructor present in this class. Hence, it automatically supplies a default constructor. Default constructor. Okay, this is how it works. Whether it is default constructor or custom constructor, the constructor name and the class name must be same. Okay, now we will understand what is the purpose of writing the custom constructor, because already a default constructor is supplied by compiler. Then along with that, why do we need to write the custom constructor? Okay, let me take you through one case study or a realistic scenario. Imagine just one second. One second. Sorry for it. Okay. Fine. Let us see a scenario. I'm going to write, imagine in your computer or in your laptop, you have to create some file, any simple file. Okay. Can you create any file, but I don't want to give any name for the file? I'll repeat, I'm going to create a file, but I don't want to give any name for this file. Is it possible? So if you don't give, let's say same system, I create a new some file, text file I create. Observe, this is a physical file which I'm creating in this computer. It means to say, if you compare this with the program, this file is an object. This file is an object. Now I created an object. This object, I don't want to name this object. Okay, that is, I'm creating a file, but I'm not naming this file. Observe, even if I don't name anything, by default some name is given for this file. New text document, that is the name of this file. So what I'm trying to tell you is, if you create a file in your disk, by default some name is taken. Or in another way, you cannot create a file without the name. I just want to create a file, but later I will give you, I'll give some name for the file. It is not possible. So at the time of creating the file itself, you have to give the name. And if you don't give the name, then by default it's going to be new text document or new Word file, depending on what type of files we are creating. Okay, so consider this is an object. So file is an object. Okay, if you consider file as an object, this object has few states, because I said that every object has states and behavior. So when I create a state, when I create a file object, it has few states. What are the states? For example, name of the file, size of the file, what type of file it is, right? Whether it is a Word file, whether it's an Excel file, whether it is a text document, right? So what are the behaviors? I can open the file, I can close the file, I can delete the file, I can modify the file, right? These are all behaviors, that is actions. So if you take file as an example, for an object, then file has states and behaviors. And we already know that if we want to create any object in programming language, then we need to have class. That's why I write a class, I write a simple class called as file. So I write a class called as file class. Okay. Then I write few properties like string name, of the file. Okay. String type of the file, and then I write let's say size double. I consider double size of the file. Okay, these are all the states, and there are some behaviors like open, close and all. I can just write it as a method. Open is one method, void, close is the method, void, close is another method. Okay, so these are all the methods like modify, etc., etc. Okay, let's not consider, just for time being, let us not consider these behaviors, because from constructor perspectives, behavior is not required. I'm going to ignore it. Okay, I'm ignoring it. Okay, let us consider only states. Now I want an object. If I want an object, I need a class. Hence, I have written a class. I have written a simple class. Is there any constructor in this class? No. No, there is no constructor written in this class. Now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to save the file and I'm going to compile the file. If successfully the compilation happens, then if the compilation is successful, then I get a dot class file. We call that as file.class, and this is called file.java. This is file.java, and this is after successful compilation. After successful compilation, we have got the dot class file. Super. Now you should remember, the compilation happens by taking the help of something called compiler. Who is the compiler? Java C is the compiler. So I said that at the compile time, Java compiler observes, is there any constructor present? Since there is no constructor present, the Java C compiler adds one default constructor. So can I say the default constructor is present in this class? This is the default constructor. Please try to understand, the constructor does not have any return type. It's very important. The constructor does not have any return type, as like methods do have, but constructor does not have any return type. Even not void also. Okay, just to give you an example, if I write a class, just a method, let's say a void m is a method, Why void? Because the method is not returning anything, hence it is void. But the constructor is return any class name, for example file, open, close. There is no return type here, not even void. Okay, constructor does not have any return type. So you should know, in method purpose is, what is the purpose of method? To get some task done, to get some functionality done, or to get some work done. So it may have return type, or if it doesn't have any return type, void. But in case of constructor, the purpose of constructor is not to get some work done. The purpose of constructor is to create an object. Okay, and it does not have any return type. Should be very clear with the purpose of writing a method and purpose of writing the constructor. Okay, so coming back to this example, we were trying to understand what is the need of custom constructor. Since I have written a class without any constructor, and when I compile, at that time Java C compiler adds one default constructor to the class. So this class now has only default constructor. Let's say objects are created in the heap memory. Objects are created in the heap memory. Okay, and now I write a program for creating an object. Okay, for example, file f equal to new file f equal to new file. I have created this object. Where the object is created? Object is created in the heap memory by the JVM. That is, when a constructor is called by the new keyword, then it is like a calling bell which invokes the JVM, and JVM is going to create an object in the heap memory with some memory location. Class name is file, memory location, some memory location, 7461 is the memory location. This is first step. Once an object is created, second step is the states are shared. What are the states or variables? Name, type, size. They are shared. Okay, name, type, and then size. These three things are shared. Now observe, are they initialized here? No. That's why at the time of object creation, if the states or instance variables present in a class, if they are not initialized, then JVM initializes that to its default value. This we have already understood. What is the default value? The default value depends on the data type. Since the data type of name and the data type of type is string, the default value for string is null, and the default value for size, what is the data type of size? It is double. Hence the default value of this is 0.0. Now this is how at the programming level the file object is created. If you look into this, what is the meaning of null? The meaning of null is nowhere existing state. Something which is not physically existing is called as null. It is not a junk value. Okay, it's not the junk value. Now, having said that, if you compare this, this is programmatic understanding. If you compare this with realistic understanding, let's say in your computer, you created a file. You created a physically one file is created, but this file does not have any name and this file does not have any type. But size is 0.0. Size wise it is fine, because when since I don't add any content into it, the file size is 0.0. But think, can you create a file without the name, without the type? Is it possible? Maybe in Linux type is not considered, because there we don't have the question of we don't have the concept of type there. But compared to Windows, just take an example of Windows as an operating system. I created a file but does not have any name, does not have any type. How is this possible? That is, you are trying to programmatically do something which is not possible in the real life. Understand this. So the purpose of programming language or purpose of software is to do something which is really required in our day-to-day life or in our real life. That is, programs cannot do some jadu or magic which is not possible in the real time. Correct? So hence, having said that, so I have come across a need. What is that need? I want to create an object, and at the time of creating the object, it is not after creating the object, it is at the time of creating an object, I want to initialize some of the properties. At the time of creating an object, I have a need that I need to initialize few properties. What properties? It is my need. In this example, I want to initialize the name, I want to initialize the type. This has to happen at the time of object creation, but not after the object creation. Why I'm insisting this at the time of object creation? Observe. Now, first step, object is already created. First step, object is already created. Now, I'm going to initialize f.name. f.name equal to something data. Name of the file is data. f.type. What is the type of the file? I say txt file. What is the type of file? Txt file. So this is a second step process. This is a second step process. So the first step is object creation. Second step is object instantiation. Please observe, the second step is object instantiation. So first step is object creation, second step is object instantiation. Clear? So here I am, object creation, object instantiation is happening as two separate steps. Clear? This happens by using default constructor, no doubt about it. Observe, this is default constructor. I'm creating an object by using the default constructor. Done. Second step, I'm instantiating. Instantiation means initialization of the variable is technically called as instantiation or object creation, object instantiation. Put together is a complete object is created. Okay. Or in a simple way, it is initialization. Initialization, okay. That is, I'm going to initialize the properties. Now, what I actually want? I want an object to be created, and at the same time, I want the states or variables to be initialized. That is, these two steps must work like a single step. In that case, I use something called custom constructor. Let us see the example of this custom constructor, or how do we write this custom constructor and how to fulfill the need. Okay, let me just delete everything. Let me write from the scratch the program. Now I write a class. I write a class called as file. Open the brace, close the brace. So this is called as the class scope. This is called as a class scope. Now I write states. For example, string name. String type, and then integer size, so integer or double. Okay, let me take that as double only. double size. Okay, so we do have three different states. Okay, now let me write a custom constructor. I said that whether it is custom constructor or default constructor, the constructor name and the class name must be same. Class name is file, constructor name is also file. But the constructor does not have any return type, not even void. Okay, then I make this constructor to take some inputs. Example, string name of the file. Okay, then string type of the file. String type of the file. That is, I have written a constructor with some parameters. This is called custom constructor. What logic I write inside this custom constructor is, I take an example, I am going to initialize the name property and I'm going to initialize the type property, but I'm not going to do anything with the size. Okay, then I'm going to initialize that. I just say name equal to nm. Okay, and then type equal to tp. Name equal to nm, type equal to tp. Please observe what I'm doing here. I'm initializing the name and initializing the type. To what value? Whatever the value which comes as an input, for that I'm initializing. Just observe. Now there is no default constructor here. If I create an object like this, for example, file, f equal to new file, it gives you compilation error because I am trying to access default constructor which is not present in this class. Why this default constructor is not present in this class? Because in this class compiler has not supplied the default constructor. Why it has not provided? Because I have written something called custom constructor. I said that in a class you can either have custom constructor or default constructor, but not both. Hence, since I have written a custom constructor, compiler has not supplied the default constructor, but still you are trying to call that default constructor. Hence this gives you compilation error. This is absolutely wrong code. Then how I'm supposed to create an object? You can create an object using file f equal to new file of, new file of, you have to pass, observe, you have to pass two parameters. This is called parameters and the values are called as arguments. What is the data type? Data type is string. I need to pass the name of the file. Let's say name of the file is data, comma, what is the value for type? Type is, let's say, txt file. Now observe, I am calling a constructor by passing the arguments. Now what happens? Data is the value. Data is added to this, and txt is the value added to this. That is, the name of the file is data, type of the file is text file, and you are calling this by using new. any constructor, whether it is custom or default, it is called by using a keyword called new. Hence two things would happen now. One is object is created. Where the object is created? Of course, the object is created in the heap memory. In the heap memory, object is created with some memory location. Class name is file, some memory location 2161 example. States are shared. What are the states? States are name, type, third thing, size. What are the values for this? It's very important. Name of the file is data. What is the type of the file? TXT file. What is the size? 0.0. Observe, I am in the constructor, I am initializing only two variables, but there are totally three variables. A possibility is 3 or 30 or 100, any number of variables. So inside the constructor, whatever the variables that needs to be initialized at the time of object creation, those things can be initialized, and remaining instance variables are initialized to its default value based by the JVM. I am initializing only name and type, but I am not initializing size. So when an object is created, name and type is initialized to whatever the value of your choice, and size is automatically initialized to default value. Default value depends on data type. Size data type is double, hence the default value for this is 0.0. Now two steps is happened. I mean two steps earlier what we have seen, that is object creation and initialization. Both the thing had happened in one single line of code. Object is also created and initialization also happened. So if you want a variables to be initialized to a certain value, then go for custom constructor. Okay, so the whole story, there are only two things that a constructor can do. Option number one, object creation. Option number two, initializing the states or instance variables to your kind of custom values, that is at the time of object creation, but not after the object creation. Clear? So this is the use of custom constructor. If you don't have any such need, then don't write constructor, because constructors by default are supplied by compiler. Any questions? Let us see some examples on this, small examples. Let's say I read a class. Class called laptop. Laptop. Now how I'm going to create an object? New laptop. So this is default constructor which I'm calling, option number one, or option number two, laptop equal to new laptop. This is option number two. Okay, so in both the cases I am just calling the default constructor, and who supplied? Compiler supplied. So in this situation, I am not interested in initializing any states at the time of object creation. Correct? That's why I didn't write any custom constructor. Now I want to initialize the states at the time of object creation. For example, in this laptop, let's say I want to initialize the states, for example, double RAM. ham. Processor, some processor, okay, string processor. Okay, I want to initialize these two things. Then now you need to decide whether you want these two states, we call it as states or instance variables, states or instance variables. You have to decide whether you want these states or instance variables to be initialized at the time of object creation or after the object creation. Two situations, one is at the time of object creation, another one is after the object creation. If it is after the object creation, then still you don't require any custom constructor. For example, I just create an object, laptop, LT, new laptop. I created an object. Step number one. Step number one. Now, object is created in the heap memory. Second step, I'm initializing it. LT equal to, LT dot. LT dot, laptop dot RAM. RAM equal to, instead of double, I make it as int. I make it as integer RAM. Laptop RAM is equal to 4 GB RAM. Okay, laptop dot processor let's say Intel processor. Clear? This is second step. This is step number one. This is step number two. Step number two, that is initialization. So object creation, initialization. Initialization is happening after the object creation. Okay. Third option. This was first. This is our second. Now I want states to be initialized at the time of object creation. Then I don't have any choice. I have to go for a custom constructor. How do I write that? Custom constructor name must be same as class name, open brace, close brace, and then there is no return type. Okay, then I create integer RAM, string processor, right? I want to initialize RAM equal to R, then processor equal to p. Okay, now since I have given the custom constructor, now there is no default constructor in this program, so this line gives you error. Why error? Because you cannot create an object by using default constructor. Why? Because there is no default constructor present in this class. So in this case, the entire program is wrong. In this case, you can create an object and also you can initialize at the same time. Laptop LT equal to new laptop, and I can pass the values. Let's say integer RAM is 4 GB RAM or 8 GB RAM, whatever it is, 16 GB RAM, choice is yours. And laptop type, what is the processor type? Let's say Intel processor. Observe. Now you're calling the constructor, custom constructor, again by using new, so that an object is created. And you are initializing the values. 4 is the RAM and Intel is the processor. Correct? So object creation, initialization, both happen at the same time. both has happened at the same time. So in this case we use something called custom constructor. So earlier one example, this is another example which I have used to give. There are few more possibilities. I'm just giving you the in and out of constructors, okay? The in and out, complete possibilities. We have seen few possibilities as of now. Let us see one more situation. I have a class. I have a class, some class. For example, some class, okay. For example, pen class. Class called pen class. Pen has a property like string color of the pen. Color of the pen, and then a string type of the pen. String type of the pen. Example like whether it is a sketch pen, whether it is an ink pen, whether it's a marker pen, example, okay, any type. These are all the two states. Now my requirement is very specific. Some cases I want to create an object and I will initialize these states whenever I want. That is like this. Pen p1 equal to new pen. I create the pen object. Whenever you create the pen object, so object called pen object is created with the states like color and type. Since you are not initializing, it is initialized to default value. Default value depends on the data type. For color and type, the data type is string, hence the default values are null. Correct? Great. Now, this is my requirement. Whenever I want, I will initialize the values to my choice. For example, p1 dot color of the pen equal to blue pen. Okay. Pen1 dot type of pen equal to a teacher uses a marker pen to write, hence it is marker. So now default values like null is replaced with blue. Default value is null is replaced with marker. Great. So this is option number one. That is, in certain cases on a same class I want to create an object and whenever I want I will initialize this. I never know when. This is option number one. In the same class there are certain situations. This situation or this scenario also I need, but sometimes I need to create an object like pen p2 equal to new pen. Let's say I want to pass black pen and then color, and the type of the pen is sketch pen. Type of the pen is sketch pen. So this is one situation. That is, here initialization happens after the object creation. Here initialization is happening at the same time as like object is created. To satisfy both these needs, what do we need to do is, we write two constructors in this class. One is just one simple constructor, which look like the default constructor, but it is not default. Since you are writing it, still it is called as custom. This is option number one. Another one, pen, another constructor I'm writing, string color, string type. What I'm going to do, color equal to C, type equal to T. Observe, this is another constructor. So in this there are two constructors, one and then two, and both the constructors are custom constructors. In that, this looks like default, but it is not default. It just looks like default. It is the custom constructor. That is, in a class, we can have any number of constructors, and it is called as constructor overloading. So I'll repeat, in a class, whenever we have more than one constructors, it is called as constructor overloading. As like in the recorded session, I've spoke about method overloading. Here it is called as constructor overloading. Obviously, the name of the constructors are same, because any constructor that we write, the name of the constructor must be the same as name of the class. Of course, all the constructors have the same name because they are the constructors of the same class. But what is the difference? Parameter is the difference. In that video, I clearly explained there are three differences. First is number of parameters. Number of parameters is 0, number of parameters are 2. So there is a change in the parameter or change in the signature. That's why it is called as constructor overloading. And whenever we create an object using this, it's going to call the constructor 1. But in this case, it's going to call the constructor 2. And it can be called any number of times. I can create one more object like this. For example, pen P3 equal to new pen. Pen P3 equal to new pen. That is, this constructor, which constructor? The first constructor. Observe, the first constructor is called once again. So a class, a constructor, variables, method can be called any number of times in Java. Okay, this is called custom constructor, and this is overloaded. Fine. So whatever, to summarize, what have we understood till now? First thing, constructor is used for two purposes. One is object creation. Second one, initialization of the states or instance variables at the time of object creation. Clear? Constructor name must be same as the class name. Constructor does not have any return type. In a class, we can have any number of constructors. Then it is called as constructor overloading. In which situation we write custom constructor? Whenever we want to create an object and initialize the states of our choice to our own values, then we go for custom constructor. If we write any one custom constructor in a class, then compiler does not supply any default constructors. Correct? Okay. And if we have the states, it is not mandatory to initialize all the states inside the constructor. Example, I have 10 states. 10 states. Out of 10, I can initialize only 2 states in a constructor. Remaining 8 is automatically initialized to its default value based on the data type by the JVM. This is about your constructor. And the constructors are called by using the new keyword. And constructors can also be called by using this and super, which we are going to discuss in future classes, not now. There's only 3 ways that constructor can be called. You cannot call the constructor in any other way. Okay, so this is about the constructor. So if you have any questions in the constructor, you can ask me. Let us start again. In this session, we will understand how a constructor can be called or invoked. The constructor can be invoked or called in 3 different ways. Option number 1, by using new keyword. option number 2 by using this, option number 3 by using super. Okay, there is no other way of calling the constructor. In this I'm going to defer, that is the way of calling a constructor by using super will be taught to you after inheritance. We will learn in our future classes something, one OOPS concept called as inheritance. So after learning inheritance, let us talk about super. So as of now, let us talk only about this and this. Out of this, we already have seen how to call the constructor by using new keyword. Correct? Now let us understand how to call the constructor using this. Not much practically used, but still, just as the part of the syllabus, I'm going to cover this. I write some constructor in a class. This class, simple example, I write a class called as EA class. Class name is A. Obviously, constructor name must also be A. I write few constructors. One is A. One constructor. Another constructor I write in a class called A. Is it possible? This is not possible because it is considered as duplication. In a class, duplication of constructors or duplication of methods are not possible. So this cannot be called as overloaded constructors because the signatures are same. Observe, zero parameter, zero parameters. So there has to be a change in the signature. Now just an example, integer I. So this is one constructor, this is another constructor. Now we can call this as overloaded constructors because there is a change in the signature. Here zero parameter, here one parameter, there is a change in the signature. I can write one more constructor also in the same class called as A. String, yes, something. This and this is called as overloaded constructor because zero parameter, one parameter. So there is a change in the number of parameters. There's a change in number of parameters. And this can also be called as overloaded because there is a change in the number of parameters. Here zero parameter, here one parameter. What about these two? This can also be considered as constructor overloading because obviously they are both are constructor of the same class, but number of parameter is one, here also number of parameter is one, right? Number of parameter is one, here number of parameter is one. Now it will go for the second option. What is that? Data type. The data type of this parameter is int, and here the data type is string. Hence this is also called as constructor overloading. Data type. First is number of parameters. Second preference is given for data type. Correct. So these are all just some dummy examples to give you a better insight about constructor overloading. We can have any number of constructors. Okay. Good. Now, in some part of the program, just let me erase this. In some part of the program, if I create an object either like this, new A, anonymous object without the reference, or maybe with the reference, A equal to new A, which constructor is called? Let us name the constructor 1, I call it as 2, I call it as 3, correct? Now, if you call then which constructor is called? One constructor, because this is the constructor without any parameters. So this constructor is called, one second while going, please don't close the door. Option number one. Now if I create or call any constructor like new a of, I pass hello. Now which constructor is called? Hello is the string value. So which constructor takes string as the argument? The third constructor. Hence this time it is going to call third constructor. Now if I pass again a1 equal to new a, again the first constructor is called because I'm not passing any argument, correct? Again if I say a2 equal to new a of qspiders, so qspiders is the value which I'm passing as an argument. The data type of this value is string, hence the constructor 3 is called because it is taking one string value. If I call, let's say a new a of 20, then 20 is the integer value, hence it's going to call second constructor. This is how we call the constructor using the new keyword, okay, and sequence of calling. Now let's say because of some reasons, let's not worry about what is the reason now, because of some reason, if one constructor has to call an another constructor of the same class, I'll repeat, for any reasons, if one constructor of a class wants to call another constructor of the same class, then it can call by using keyword called this, by using a keyword called this along with the parenthesis. Now it's going to call the first constructor. So a constructor of the class cannot call another constructor of the same class in this fashion. It cannot call like this by the name. No, it has to give respect. It gives the respect by using this. It cannot call by the name. Repeat, any constructor wants to call another constructor of the same class, then it uses this. It uses this. Okay, first thing, remember this. Second thing, once a constructor calls the other constructor of the same class, then it cannot call other remaining constructors. That is, just to summarize, a constructor in a class can call only one constructor and only once. I'll repeat, a constructor of a class can call the other constructors of the same class only once by using this. Okay, I just erase this. For example, in the same class, let's say I write one more constructor. I write a constructor, for example, A. I write string hello. Sorry, string yes. So three constructors are there in a class. Since I don't have space here, I have written the constructor here, okay? So these three are the constructors of the same. Now you decide. It can call either first constructor or second constructor. Either it can call first or the second constructor. How? By using this. If you want to call the first constructor, you can use this. And remember, it can call only once. You cannot write like this. You cannot write the code like this. Not possible. Why? Because you are calling a constructor twice. Not possible. A constructor can call the other constructor, any other constructor of the same class, only once. Now you cannot call this and this of 20, thinking that it is going to call the first one and this is going to call the second one. Not possible. Only one time a constructor can call. Clear? Then calling the constructor must be the first line of code. I'll repeat, the calling the constructor must be the first line of code. What is the meaning? Let's say I write some code in this constructor. Let me clean this, okay? Otherwise you'll be confused. Okay, fine. Let's say this is my constructor. I'm going to print some message. System.out.println of hello. Some message, hello message. This is called as any line that is executed is called as executable line of code. So this is one executable line of code. Now I'm thinking to call by using this of 20. You think that so system.out.println is called and this of 20 is going to call this particular constructor because you are passing 20. No, it gives you error. Why? Because calling the constructor must be the first line of code in any constructor. Clear? So this code must be present here, then you can do any other code. Clear? That's it. Two things you need to remember. So this is used to call the constructor of the same class, and in one constructor, calling the other constructor must be the first line of code, and only once any other constructors of the same class can be called. Clear? Let us see some practical examples. Though I have written all the programs here, let me explain you the program by writing. I have created a project. Create a new class, some class called as pen. Created a class called as pen. I have removed that package because I have not created any package yet. So a class called pen is created. Dot class is also generated. This is called one constructor. Color of the constructor. Type of the constructor. Type of the pen. Sorry, not the constructor. Type of the pen. Let's say that's it. Maybe I can say double price of the pen. I write this, can I call it as states or instance variables. These are all called states and instance variable. This is called zero param constructor. I can write one more constructor. Now observe, it is giving you error. Why it is giving you error? Because this is called duplication. Duplicate. See, duplicate. It is giving method instead. It is like a constructor. Okay. It is saying that duplicate constructors are not possible. So now what do? I just mention string color, string CLR, and then I write string type. Observe, this is 0 parameter, this is 2 parameter constructor. Now I just say color equal to CLR, okay, and then I just say type equal to TYP. Okay, now I write system.out.println inside 2 param constructor, inside 2 parameter constructor. Okay, I can write one more constructor. I write integer or double price. I just mention price equal to price. I am initializing the price. Here I am initializing color and type. Okay, and here I'm not initializing anything, it's just a constructor. Okay, now I just write inside 0 param constructor. Inside 1 param constructor. Clear? So this put together, it is called as constructor overloading. Now I write a class here. Okay, I call it as test class. I'm going to add public static void main and let it be in a default package. Click on finish. Now how can you call the constructors of one class from the other class? Constructors can be called only in 3 different ways. One is by using new, one is by using this, another by using super. Super we will not see now. New can be called this can be used only to call a constructor from another constructor of same class, but I am now totally calling them from some other class. So obviously I need to call them by using new pen. Now which constructor is called? I'm calling the constructor without passing any value, hence this is executed. Just run this program, run as Java application inside 0 param constructor. Okay, now this constructor can call other constructor. For example, this of 25 rupees. I said that one constructor of a class can call the other constructor of the same class by using this, but still why it is giving error? Because calling a constructor must be the first executable line. Constructor call must be the first statement in a constructor. Observe this message. That's why this must be the first executable line of code. Okay, now what happens whenever you're calling new pen? Okay, it's going to call this, and this constructor is executed. First line is calling this. It goes here, initializes the price of the pen to 25 rupees, then it prints inside one parameter constructor, comes back, then it prints system.out.println inside 0 param constructor, then it comes back to the main method. Okay, now run the same program inside 1 param constructor, then inside 0 param constructor. Clear? If you try to call once again, for example, some value 50, not possible. I said that only one constructor can call the other constructor only once. This is not possible. correct? It gives you error. This example I can mail you, you can use it. Whatever we discussed, that has been covered. Now let's say pen p1 equal to new pen of, I can directly call by passing some value, let's say 60. Now what happens? The pen with the 60, this value is, this constructor is executed. Run as Java application. Inside one parameter constructor. And you can print that value if you want, PR. It prints inside one parameter constructor, and whatever the value that we pass for PR is printed. Sorry, run as Java application. It prints inside one parameter constructor 60.0, because I'm passing the value called 60. Okay, this is how it works. So please ask me questions. So we are almost done with the constructor. Okay. Yeah. Hello.
Yeah, Shishila.
Yes, please.
As you said, calling the constructor by this keyword or this method is not practically used. Like, it is rarely used. So not what are those rare instances?
Yeah. Okay. So what's your this is Kavya, or I mean, who exactly? Shweta. Okay. So I said that not much practically used, correct? And after that, I could not understand. Can you repeat that question?
Yeah. So what are the rare instances when this can be used?
Okay, fine. If I take through some instances, maybe it becomes little difficult for you to understand at this moment. Okay. So as a part of Selenium, when we explain the Selenium code, you will clearly understand this, because you are already, probably you would have already experience of writing manual test cases, correct? So when we take that situation, and for those kind of test cases, when we try to write the code, that time we'll compare this situation and we'll explain to you. Okay. Is it fine, Shweta?
Yeah, fine.
I mean, don't feel that I just suppressed the question. Okay.
No.
Because I'm just telling you that kind of situations we will create and explain you. Whatever we learn in Java, that all the situations and scenarios, we are going to create a Selenium code. Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Any other question from anyone? Sarvana says no. Venkat, very well explained. Okay. Thanks, Al. Fine. So let us move on. And one more thing I'll explain. There is something called this. There is something called this. But you say this is already covered. Okay. If I write this with this parenthesis, this is going to call the constructor. But there is a keyword called this. But there is no parenthesis. Please observe. This with the parenthesis means constructor. This is just the this without the parenthesis. It is a reserved word or keyword. You can call it as a keyword. What is the meaning? When I say this, it talks about current instance. Current instance. The current instance is called as this. I'll explain this with a code so that you will easily understand. Now you would have got somewhat confusion. Okay. I write simply a code. There is a class called pen. Color of the pen, let's say black pen. So the default value of the color of the pen is black. Okay, but that is if someone creates an object pen p equal to new pen. Now what happens is I'm calling a default constructor, object is created. Now if I print system dot out dot println of p dot color, it prints the value called black. Why? Because an object is created, state is initialized to black. But I also give an option to the user to initialize it to the user's choice by writing custom constructor. I write string, I write just the pen constructor. Just write string C. C stands for color. I write the code here, this dot color. This dot color equal to C. This dot color equal to C. What we need to understand when we write the code is this means a current instance. Let me explain with the memory location. Okay, let's say here is the memory, heap memory. All the objects are stored in this heap memory. I create an object pen p1 equal to new pen. What exactly happens? P1 referring to a reference, referring to an object. The object is created in the heap memory. Okay, not only that, this is a class. Class is a logical entity. One instance of this variable is shared here. It gives you error because we are calling a default constructor, but there is no default constructor in this class. Correct? Hence what I'm supposed to do, I have to call by using, let's say for example, blue. Now blue is the value that you are passing, right? So color becomes what? Blue. So when you say this here, it is, many people think that it is referring to the variable. Yes, it refers to the variable, but at the memory level when we talk, this is a variable which is declared inside the class. When I say inside a class, class is a logical entity which is not physically present. What is physically present? The object is physically present. So when you say this dot color, it is the meaning the current object color, the current pen object color is C. Which is the current pen object? This is the current pen object. Correct? With this, when you say p1 dot color, it is blue color. So this means a current object, because somewhere class is stored in your memory location. Okay, this is the meaning of this class, is just a logical entity. But here color, one copy of the variable is present. Now I create one more object, pen p2 equal to new pen of, let's say, red pen. Now what happens? One more object is created, color becomes red. Now like that I create 100 objects, pen p100 equal to p100 or whatever it is, equal to new pen of, I pass some values like green. Now totally in your heap memory 100 objects are present, color equal to green. In your heap memory 100 objects are present. Now when I say this, which one it refers? There are 100 copies. This is present in the class, which is just a declaration or a logical entity, but 100 instances are present. So this means the current instance p1, from the perspective of p1, this means this. From the perspective of p2, this means this one. From the perspective of p100, this means this color. So the meaning of this is the current instance. Are you clear? So if you pass this along with the brackets or parentheses, it becomes constructor. Okay. I write one more code. Just observe this code, okay? I just write something, observe this, okay, I write code like this, car. String model, so model equal to MDL, this is option number one. Another way of writing the same code, this is also constructor. All right, this dot model equal to MDL. Please observe these two code, everyone. Option number one. This is option number two. First option, second option. If you closely observe this entire code, the only difference is this. Here I'm accessing this dot model, here directly accessing. Just observe this code, later I'll explain. Got it? Functionally, option number one and option number two works the same. I'll repeat, functionally both works the same, okay? But I personally say this is a good choice. Option number two is a good choice, just a choice. You definitely may ask, when functionally both are same, how second one is a good option, right? that, let me take you through one situation. For time being, keep it aside. Just keep it aside, okay? Just keep this aside. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to erase this. Okay. Oh, I have a question here for you. Can I say this as one variable? What variable it is called as? Instance variable. It is called as instance variable. If you ask me question like why it is called as instance, because I'm going to create an instance of this. Instance means object of this, and this variable will be present within that object. I create a new car, object of the car is created, correct? When I say new car, object of the car is created, model is shared. This object is called as instance. Since it is shared with the instance, it is called as instance variable. Okay, I write this code also to avoid confusion. Car C equal to new car. Okay, model of the car is Ford Figo. So object, this is the way that we call the constructor. Now one object is created in the heap memory, right? When the heap memory, which is the class, car class, with some memory location, but this variable is shared with one instance. This is called one instance of a class. So model is shared. Okay, and what is the value? Ford Figo. Ford Figo. But if you observe, this variable, this is also one variable. This is called local variable. What do we call it as? Local variable. This is instance variable. This is called local variable. And this variable is never shared with the instance. Only instance variables are shared with the instances, but local variables are not shared. They have the temporary life. At the time of execution of this constructor, this variable is created, and after the execution, that variable is destroyed. But this variable, which lives inside the heap memory as the part of the object, is destroyed only when this object is destroyed. So the lifetime of an instance variable is much more higher when compared to the lifetime of this local variable. And local variables are created, destroyed, as and when they're called. And they are never shared with the instances. So this is the small difference between a local variable and the instance variable. Okay, clear? You need to be very clear on this, so that now I'll start explaining the other situation. Okay. Now, what if by chance, what if I write a code? By chance, what if I write a code? Model. Observe this kind of code. Whenever I write a code, this is an instance variable. This is a local variable. This is a local variable. Fortunately or unfortunately, the name of the local variable, name of the local variable and the name of the instance variable is same. Situationally, they are same. You understand? So in this situation, the entire things, I mean, can be same, and 99% of the cases, this name and this name are the variables, local variables and the instance variables names are kept same. Kept same. In this case, which is considered? Correct? So now to differentiate between a local variable and the instance variable, we use the keyword called this. This dot model means, this dot model means it's going to refer this model. Okay, when I say this dot model, it refers instance variable, because this means current instance one. What is shared with the instance? This variable is shared with the instance, but this local variable is not shared. That's why this dot model refers to instance variable. And if I just write equal to model, now this model refers to local variable. Understood? So whenever the instance variable and local variable names are same, if you refer the variable directly without using this, then it refers to local variable. It refers to local variable. But if you use this keyword, then it refers to instance variable. So bottom line is this, this can also be used to differentiate between an instance variable and the local variable. Okay, I'll give you one more beautiful example so that you will feel very comfortable. Okay, just I'll write the program for it. Add a class, okay, car class. Car class. In this car class, I write one constructor, or I write one variable. String model of the car is, let's say, Honda City. This is the model, okay? Let me write it in orange color. Now, what do? I write the class, I write a constructor called car constructor. String model. This also I'll keep same name. This is local variable. I keep it in green color, let's say. Fine. Just a local variable. So this is a local variable, green color. This is an instance variable, but the names are same. Now here I write a program, system.out.println. I print model. What value is printed? Somewhere I write a code. Car c equal to new car of, let's say, what value is printed. Yes, Shweta is telling Ford Figo is printed. Correct. Correct. Let me explain this to you guys. This is called, from here within this, this is called local scope. This is called local scope. Okay. In the local scope, within the local scope, the local variables dominate over instance variable. I'll repeat. Within the local scope, local variables dominate over instance variable. Okay, now? So with this scope, when you say model, first preference is given for local variable. So local variable called model dominates over the instance variable. Hence, in this scope, when I say model, it is the local variable. Same way. I write one more constructor. It's a simple constructor here, just a constructor, okay. Here I write system.out.println of model. In this, observe, this is a local variable. The scope starts from this brace and ends with this brace. This cannot be accessed, or model local variable of this constructor cannot be accessed on the other constructor, because scope starts here, scope ends here. Here when you say model, it refers to instance variable. It prints, here it prints Honda City. It prints Honda City. But here it prints you are calling new and the constructor, you're calling the constructor with the Ford Figo value. So the value of the model local variable is Ford Figo, hence it prints Ford Figo. So what I'm trying to tell you is, in local scope, local variables dominate over instance variables. Now I want Honda City to be printed here, then you left with only one choice, system.out.println this dot model. Clear? Now it's going to print Honda City. It prints Honda City. So this is a variable which is used to differentiate between a local variable and an instance variable. Clear? This dot model equal to Honda City. Here it prints Ford Figo. Hope you understood this. And this situation we come across only when the instance variable name and the local variable names are same. If it is different, if the local variable and the instance variable names are different, instead of model, if it is MDL, then you need not to use this also. Correct? Not required. And if you use also, nothing will happen, but it is not required. But typically, remember, in the industry, we generally keep the local variable name and the instance variable names as same. Question, you may ask a question, why that leads to confusion? Actually speaking, no. What happens is when you start writing a program for a big project, you come across lakhs and lakhs or thousands and thousands of variables. And every time finding new name for the variable is very difficult. Clear? It's very difficult. You cannot simply create a variable I, J, K, L, SS, MM. This is not the standard. You should give some meaningful name. If it is salary, you need to at least give sal or SALA salary or SLRY salary. So that by looking into this name, one can understand what its entity it is. So in such situation, keeping multiple variables with different names like salary 1, salary 2 and all, it becomes very difficult. Okay, that's why we try to give diversified names for the variable. We keep the same name. So keeping that in mind, the keyword called this helps you a lot to differentiate between a local variable and an instance variable. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Okay, let us now understand altogether a new concept called as packages. Packages, okay, in Java. So before I start with a programmatic paradigm of packages or programmatic understanding of packages, let me first would like to give some examples, some realistic examples. Then I will compare those realistic examples with packages. Okay. Think about this in our day-to-day life. Okay. Let's say we come home from office. I'm just taking India as the context, okay? So we come from office or we come from outside to home. First thing, we remove our footwears and we keep our footwears probably on the rack. We call it as shoe rack. Correct. We keep all of our footwear in this rack. Then we get inside. Once you get inside, you are getting freshen up. You change your dress and you keep all your dresses in a wardrobe. You keep all your dresses in wardrobe, right? Then you are feeling very tired and you want to relax. Now you go to kitchen. In kitchen, all the groceries, eatables, food, beverages are kept in the kitchen or arranged in the kitchen. Correct. This is our just day-to-day life activity. The question, why all the clothes are kept in the wardrobe? Why not somewhere in the hall? Why not in the veranda? You can keep everything in kitchen only, no? Or why the groceries are kept in the kitchen? Why not on the shoe rack? Or why not on somewhere else? So, because of two reasons. The first thing, organizing the things in its place helps you in easy maintenance. Correct. Tomorrow morning you are in hurry to reach office. At that time you need not to search for your shoe in the whole house. Correct. You just have to go there, get the shoe from the shoe rack. So easy accessibility, first thing. Correct. So if you are searching for a new dress, let's say tomorrow you need to go to office with some color dress, some ethnic day in your office, you need not to search for the dress because complete dress is available in the wardrobe. You need not to search in the entire house. Now you are very hungry, you want to prepare some food. You need not to search for groceries and eatables in the entire house. You just have to go to kitchen. Everything is available. So here we are achieving few things. One is better or easy maintenance. Second thing, search becomes very easy. Whatever you want, you can easily search that. You want a food, you can search that easily. You want dress, you can search that easily. Another one, accessibility. Accessibility becomes very easy for you. Beyond and everything, it is a better and easy and a good maintenance. Correct? Now, why I'm talking about this? Whenever we develop the project, in the project also, take an example of testing. We have a lot of resources in testing. We have test cases. We have test suites. we have test data, we have resources like document related to the project, requirement documents, we have project related in the support. If you are working with supports, there are a lot of tickets raised, so they are all maintained in some softwares if you are using QC or Bugzilla or somewhere. Correct. So as a project, you deal with a lot of resources. Correct. Similarly, from the development perspective, if you are developing the project, you come across many classes, many resources like classes, resources like images, resources like configuration files of the project, right? It can be requirement document, it can be my design related documents, right? So, and some other pages in the web pages, CSS file for theming, HTML web pages. Like this, we come across lot many resources in the project. Whenever we are dealing with multiple resources, when I say you write a class in Java, we don't just write one or two classes. In the project, I write thousands and thousands of classes. I use thousands of, if not thousands, hundreds of configuration files. Many other resources I use. That's why it's better to keep, or it's better to maintain all these resources in a proper structured manner. Okay, so when you keep all the resources in a structured manner, maintenance of the project becomes very easy. You can achieve modularity. You can achieve modularity. You can search becomes very easy for you. If you want to search some, let's say now you developed one page. In this page, some let's say username is there, password is there, and a button is there. After, let's say, 6 months, some enhancement comes from the client. The client says that in this page, I want a user tip to be added. I want some design to be changed here. Clear? In the 6 months of the project, you would have developed thousands and thousands of such web pages. Now, in which page the modification has to be done, you need to search. Instead of that, if you keep these pages in a proper folder structure, okay, the searching of the particular page becomes easy for you. I'm just taking an example of a page. It can be any other resources. Okay, imagine you're working on a very big application, as like a Gmail application, right? You create one application or a project called Gmail project. You keep all the resources inside this Gmail project, all the thousands and thousands of resources you are keeping inside this project. This is one option. Or second option, you organize, manage in a proper structure way. It's like my project, Gmail as the project. I have different modules in my Gmail project. For example, it can be inbox, it can be draft, settings, sent mails, stars, themes, different things, okay? So, all project related files which are related to inbox, please store that in inbox folder. Draft related, keep that in draft. In settings, you can again create some more folders. Settings related to account, settings related to personal information, settings related to the themes, right? Any programs or any files related to account, keep it under account. Related to information, keep it under information. This gives you a better structure for the project, maintenance becomes very easy, search becomes easy. Tomorrow if you get enhancement related to inbox, you need not to search in the entire project like this. Just go to the inbox folder, start searching for the files, search becomes very easy, accessibility becomes very easy. Overall, the project maintenance becomes very, very easy. And this is a typical directory or a folder or a directory. This directory or folder which we talk is in Java is called as a package. If someone asks what is a package, at the nutshell, a package is nothing but a simple folder or a directory. And why do we implement this package in Java project? Because better maintenance of the project, searching of the resources becomes easy, accessibility of the resources is very easy and faster. Okay, and there is one more advantage, we can achieve encapsulation. It's a new word which I'm introducing. There is something called encapsulation. Packages helps you to achieve encapsulation. How? We will talk about this in object-oriented principle. This is our next topic. That is from tomorrow, we are going to talk about object-oriented principles. At that time when I introduce encapsulation, let us discuss, not now. Okay? So what's a package? A package is nothing but a simple folder. Right now, for example, here I just have created the programs directly under source. Instead of creating under source, let's say create a new Java project. I call it as Gmail project. Click on finish. I create it as a Gmail project. In the Gmail project, instead of creating all the programs, Java programs directly under SRC, it's better that you create some folders. For example, you create a package. Okay, the package name is, let's say, inbox. Package name is inbox. Click on finish, package is created. You create another package called as sent mails. Create a package, let's say, called as settings. Under settings, you can create some other packages like themes. Under setting, create another package like accounts, account related settings, right? So they're all called as packages, nothing but a simple folders. Okay, now what is the standard guidelines that I should follow once creating a package? What is the structure? Can I create however I want? No. There is, for Java project, there is a standard package structure that we follow. It is just an industry practice, okay? There is no rule for it. There is no rule for it, okay? How? What is a package structure? Whenever you create a project, your project, consider a Java project, even Selenium project also. First thing, we create one package. That's nothing but a folder package called as either com or org. Remember, there is a standard, the package name must be in lowercase. Just a standard, okay? A standard that package name must be in lowercase, and package name must not be any Java, keyword. For example, in Java, we have a keyword called class, we have a keyword called int, we have a keyword called string, right? They are all inbuilt. You cannot create a folder or a package with the name class. You cannot create with a folder by name int. No. Right? So, and you should not give any space. No space. No space. No special character. No special character, no underscore, no nothing. Okay, never use any special characters. I'm just talking about the standards. So package name must be lowercase. You must not use any keywords. okay, and no space, no special characters. Now once you create a project, create a folder called com or org. What is the meaning of com? Com stands for commercial, org stands for organization. If you are developing an open source project, start with org. If you are developing a commercial project, starts with com. It depends on what type of project that you are working on. Com or org. Under this, company name. Company name. Under, I'll write that project structure by taking some example also. First, just let me write this structure. Under company name, you can write application name. Under application name, module name. Module 1, module 2, right? Like this, any module. So this is the standard package structure that we follow in Java application. Project, either commercial or organization, company name, application name, module, different modules. Just to give you an example of Gmail project, under the project, let's say this is your Gmail project. Under that, first, let's say it's a commercial, it's not open source. Let's start with com. Under com, what's the company name? Company name is, let's say, Google. Google has many application. One of the application is Gmail. Like that, they have other applications like YouTube, Picasa, etc., etc. Under Gmail, they have many modules. Inbox has one module, right? Sent item is another module. Sent items or sent mails. Draft is another module. Like this, you organize the project in a proper structured way or proper packages. Then any files related to inbox, keep them in the inbox. Anything related to sent items, keep them under sent items. Anything which is common for all the module but specific for the application, then you can keep that here. Okay, so this is called as a package. This is called as Google is a sub package of com package. Gmail is the sub package of Google. So understand, so these are all called as sub package. So one package can have any number of sub package, plus it can directly have the Java classes also. Clear? I'll repeat, any package, right, can have directly classes. For example, car.java, okay, pen.java. These are all classes inside the package. Along with that, it can have some sub packages also. Sub package can have any number of sub packages or classes. This can go on. Is it clear? This is about, so we understood at the bottom line what is the meaning of package and why it is needed and what is the standard structure of the package. Okay, just to give you some examples and on how to create a package. How to create a package. Create a new Java project, any project. Let's consider this as UK demo project. Click on finish. Okay. Now, what is a standard package? How do we create a package? There are two different ways. Right click on SRC, new. You can select either package or folder. At the nutshell, both are same. Package and folders, they are same. If you use package under SRC, then com dot, com is one package. Okay, or just click on finish. So com is a package which is created under SRC. Similar folder structure is created or package structure is created even inside bin also. Okay, under com I can just simply create new another package. Let's say under com dot, let's say com dot company name. Let's, for example, Qspiders. I can click on finish. instead of creating one after the other folders or packages like this, I delete this. Instead of creating one known folder, just right click, new, click on package. I just say com dot company name qspiders dot application name sample application dot, let's say package of com dot company name dot application name. Under that modules, I can create a modules like day 7 as one module, or let's say any other names. You can give any other names. Okay, click on finish. See, all the packages are created in one shot. Similar, whatever you create under SRC, the similar replica is created under bin. And if you create a new class here, what is the, in which package you are creating a class? For example, there is a class called demo. What is the meaning? The demo is a Java class which I'm creating under a folder called or package called com qspiders sample app. Click on finish. Observe, similar dot class is generated here. Here is the Java, here is the dot class. You need to observe one thing very important. Whenever I write a class inside, whenever we create a class inside a particular package, then that class should be declared with something called package. So what is the meaning? The class called demo is present in a package called com.qspiders.sampleapp. That's the meaning. So package declaration must be the first executable line of code, and package must be declared outside the class. Are we clear? So whenever you write a class within a package, okay, then package declaration must be the first executable line of code. You cannot, it cannot be something like this. I define integer I equal to 50. Then I start declaring the package. Never possible. Never possible. Okay, so package declaration must be the first executable line of code. And package must be declared outside the class. Okay, if someone asks what is the class name, then class name is demo. Class name is demo. But what is the fully qualified class name? There's a difference between class name and fully qualified class name. Class name is demo. Okay, I just write somewhere. Okay, class name is demo. The fully qualified, fully qualified class name means the class name along with the complete package. That is called fully qualified class name. There is, in Eclipse, there is an option to copy that. Select the class name, right click, copy qualified name. I'll repeat, select the class name, right click, copy qualified name. This is called fully qualified class name. Understood the difference between class name and fully qualified class name? Okay, so this is how we declare the classes within a particular package. Okay, next. I'm just going to minimize this. Now let me delete this. Let me create a package called, okay, let me create a package called p1, and let me also create another package called p2. Package called p1 and p2. Now I create under p1 package, I create a class called as, for example, car class. So car is present under a package called p1 package. So if someone asks what is a fully qualified class name, com.qspiders.sampleapp.p1.car. also let's say I'm going to create another class here called as bus class. Click on finish. Okay, so bus and car are the classes. Let's say I create last another class called as train class. So there are three classes which are present under a package called P1. So P1 is a sub package of sample app, which is a sub package of Qspiders, which is a sub package of com. So all the classes are present within the sub package called P1. Clear? Now I write another last class called as test class. Test class with something called main method. With something called main method. Okay. Now remember, these are called as package level classes. That is, all the classes are present within a package called P1. Okay. Now car has a method called drive method. Just an assumption. Simple sample code. There is a method inside a car called as driving, and the car has a model. This is the model of the car. And this is the method car. Okay, method of the car. Can I call it as the members of the class? When I say members of a class, it means the states and behaviors and also states and behaviors, and also constructor is also called as a behavior. Sorry, constructor is also called as members. So there are three members in a class: states, behaviors, and then constructors. States, behaviors, and then constructors. Put together, we call them as members of a class. Okay, now let's say, for example, car object is created by calling car constructor. Correct? This is a constructor. When someone calls this constructor, object is created. Now I'm going to create an object of car, C equal to new car. Can I say I'm calling an object now? If you run the program, see, car object is created by calling car constructor. Now I can print C dot, that is car reference dot model. I think, what is that? Yes, model. C dot model. It's going to print the value called Honda City. Let me run the program. It prints the message called Honda City. Now all these are happening within the same package. All these things are happening within the same package. Now I'm going to create a class called as test. Please observe, here is a class called as test in P2 package, and there was a class called as test in P1 package, or there is another class called as test in P1 package. So I can have duplicate files, but they must be present in two different packages. Are you clear? I can have test class in one package, another test class, but it should be present in another package, because in same package we cannot have more than one class with the same name. I cannot have one more car class in P1 package because car is already present. Okay. Now that's why class name is same, but fully qualified class name is different. This is com.qspiders.sampleapp.p2.test. This is com.qspiders.sampleapp.p1.test. So fully qualified class names are different from the actual class names. Fine. Now in this class, I'm going to write the main method. Now please observe, I want to create an object of car class from the test class, which is present in the other package called P2. Clear? Now car C equal to new car. I get an error here. Okay, because of two reasons you get an error. First thing, when I say car, car from which package? Car from which package? If I say there is a place called Manchester. Manchester is place which is present in UK, and also Manchester is another place which is present in US as well. So which Manchester you are referring to? Correct? When I say car, which car you are referring to? That's why you need to use a fully qualified class name. Understand? So what is the fully qualified class name of the car? The fully qualified class name is com.qspiders.sampleapp.p1.car. How can we copy that? Select the class name, right click, copy qualified name, and then use it here. Clear? Then C equal to new fully qualified class name. But here it is giving you an error. Why? Because observe, the class called car, which is present in another package, is a public access specifier. The class called car is public. What is the meaning? This car is a public car. This car is a public car. That is, if you want, I'll write and explain. Let's say there are two packages in a project. Package 1 and then package 2. In the package 1, I have a class called car class. Package 2, there is a class called driver class. Okay. If driver wants to use the car class, then the car, first thing, the car class must be public class. What is the meaning? If you want to access any class along with its members, what are the members? Variables, constructors, methods. If you want to access any class along with its members outside the package, then the class and members both must be public. It is called as access specifier. You specify the accessibility limit. That's why it is called as access specifier. Or access modifier. Okay, if we are going to understand in detail very soon, but before that, just I'm introducing public with all lowercase means the class can be accessed outside the package. So in the other way, if you want to access any class outside the package, then class must be public. Okay, and if a class is public, members are not public, then you can access only class, but you cannot access members. It is something like this. Let's say the bank. There is a bank. Bank is public bank. We represent public by using plus. Plus means public, okay? So when I represent a bank, bank is public. Any person can walk into the bank. It's a public property. But in the bank, there is a locker room. Everyone cannot go to this locker room. Locker room is private. Locker room is private. So I can say it as minus. Minus means private. Okay, so you understood what is the difference between public and private. Public means everyone can access. Private means only restricted people can access. So when a class is public, it does not mean that all the members inside the class is public. Wrong. A public class, plus means public, a public class can have private method, private variable, private constructor also. In that case, only class can be accessed, the internal private members cannot be accessed. Okay, so keeping that in mind, here observe, the class called car is public. State model, there is a state called model which is not public. Method is not public, but I have not mentioned it as private also. Correct? When you don't mention anything for the member, then these members are having an access specifier called default. These members has an access specifier called default, or some people also call it as package level. Some people call it as package level access specifier or default access specifier. What is the meaning? Just explain. Let's say there is a package P1. There is another package called P2. Here is a class called as car class. I don't mention it as public, private or anything else. I just don't mention anything. Then the access modifier or specifier of this class is default. When a class or any member is default, then it can be accessed within the package. It cannot be accessed outside the package. If you want to access this car class from P2 package, not possible. So what is the meaning? Default access specifier is the one which can be accessed within the package. That's the reason people also call it as package level. So any member or any class with the default access specifier can be accessed within only the package. It cannot be accessed outside. If you want to access them outside, then the member should be public. Okay, simple example. Let me delete all this. So class is public. Let me delete this also. Okay, now class is default, variable is default, method is default, constructor is default. So this car can be accessed within the other classes or from the other classes which are present within the same package. For example, I have test here. Test can access the car class because class called test and the class called car are present within the same package. I'm accessing the constructor. What is the access specifier of constructor? It is default. So that's why I'm accessing that, because test class is present within the same package. So any members and the class with the default package can be accessed within the package, and if you want to access them outside the package, observe here it is started giving you error. Why? Because car is a class which you are trying to access from the test class, which is present in another package called P2. Correct? That's why it is giving you error, because car class is a default access specifier. Now if you make it as public, car class is public, hence you can access them outside the package. If it is not public, observe, you get an error here. Understood the meaning of public? Save this, error is gone here. Clear? Now I want to create an object. I want to create an object of the car class. I need a constructor. So how do you call the constructor? New. And what is a fully qualified class name? New. Correct? Why it is giving error? Because car is a constructor which is not public, which is default. Default means which can be accessed only within the package. That's why let me make this also as public. Now observe, error is gone. Okay, next. If you try to print system.out.println of c.model, it gives you error. Why? Because observe, the field car.model is not visible. It is not visible. Why it is not visible? Because it is default, which cannot be accessed. Make this also as public. Just save the program. Observe, error is gone here. Similarly, I want to access c.drive method. Drive method is not visible. Again, make, because it is drive method is not public. So hence make this method also as public. Then error is gone here. So it's pretty simple. If you want to access any class and along with its members outside the package, then that member should be public. Having just a class public is not enough. The members also must be public. Clear? Next one. Observe this. Every time referring a class with fully qualified class name, really, it's like, you know, it is a very lengthy code. That's why what do you do? Import this class once. Import the class once and start referring it just by using class name. So what is the advantage of import? Import statement gives you fully qualified class name. So in your program, whenever you use car, car means it refers to car from com.qspiders.sampleapp.p1 package. So this reduces your code. Understand? So import statements must be used outside the class but after the package. Clear? Now I want to use bus class. Let's say I want to use bus class. Clear? So how are we going to import that bus class here? Control bus b equal to new bus. Okay, just on mouse over, just say import. It's going to import the bus. Similarly, if you want to use another train class, then just start using import p1.train. So you can use the train now. Train t equal to new train. You can start using it. Okay, so fundamental concept is this: if you want to use any classes outside the package, within the package import statements are not required. If you want to see, observe, did I import here, there is a class called test class. Did I import a car class here? No. Why need not to import? Import is applicable only if you are accessing it outside the package. Okay, if you want to access any classes outside the package, or if you want to access any classes which are present outside the package, then import them and start using it, and make sure that those classes must be public and members must be public, or only public members can be accessed. Clear? Next thing, let's say in this package I have 100 classes and you want to use all the 100 classes here. What we are supposed to do? Import all the 100 classes, which is really time consuming. Instead of that, you can just say star. Delete. What is the meaning? Import all classes. Import all the classes from this particular package. That's the meaning. Here there is one important catchy thing. When you say, let's say I'm going to create another sub package called as P12. There's a package called P12. P12 has a class called fan class. There is one more class called as, let's say, laptop class, some dummy classes. Okay, so P1 package has some classes and one more sub package called P12. P12 is a sub package of P1 which has got some classes, correct? Now if you write com.qspiders.sampleapp.p1.star, it's very important and very tricky. It will import only the classes which are directly present under P1 package, but it will not import the classes from its sub package. If you want to use the classes from the sub package, then you need to import observe com.qspiders.sampleapp.p1.p12.fan. Okay, then p12.laptop. Like this, you have to separately import them and start using them here. Fan f equal to new fan, something like this. Clear? It is giving yellow mark errors because it is saying that you are importing the class but you are not using that class here. See, imports is never used. If I use it, for example, I start using it, laptop l equal to null something, I start using it, then it doesn't give you any warning. Okay, what is understanding? So when we say star, it imports all the classes which are directly under the package, but sub package classes are not imported. You have to separately import the sub package. You can use individual class name, or you can just say this also. You can just mention this p12.star, something like this. Clear? Then in that case, these two things may not be required. Not required because you are using everything. Understood about packages? Let me just recall all the points about packages. Package is nothing but a folder in Java. Okay, folder or directory. Packages are used for better maintenance of the project. Accessibility becomes very easy, search becomes very easy. Okay, and it is, we are going to achieve modularity. These are all the advantages of package. whenever we write a class inside any package, then that class must have package declaration using a keyword called package. Package declaration must be the first executable line of code. It must be outside the class. Any number of classes and packages can be present in another package. In such case, we call it as sub packages. Okay. By default, the classes which are present within a package can be accessed from other classes of the same package without any import statement. And the classes or the members of any package can be accessed from other classes, from other packages, only if the class and its members are public. And in the other class, we need to import them before we use them. That's all. Whenever we say star while importing, it imports all the classes from that package. Star will not import the classes from its sub package. Fine. If you observe, this is implemented in Java itself. In Java itself, within Java, there are a lot of packages are present. There is a package called Java. Under the Java, there are lot many packages. One package called lang, all lowercase, okay? Lang means language fundamentals. Under lang, there are lot of classes. For example, we use commonly one class called as string. There is a class called as system. So like that, there are lot of classes are present within a package called lang. There is another package called as util, stands for utility. There is another package called as IO, input output. There is another package called as math, all related, mathematics related. There is another package called as SQL. All related SQL related classes are present here. Like that, in Java, there are huge number of packages. And what is a fully qualified name of the string? Java dot lang dot string. Okay. In util, you have a class called ArrayList. How are we going to access? java.util.arrayList. In IO, we have a class called file. If you want to read something from the file, you have a class called file reader. What is the fully name? java.io.fileReader. Clear? Here, there is one beauty that you need to understand. If you want to access any of the classes which are present under the lang package, need not to be imported. I'll repeat, if you want to access any class, there are thousands of classes are present. If you want to access any classes from the lang package, then you need not to import them. For example, let me delete all these things. Okay, I have deleted everything. Let me create a simple class called as test class. I want to access string. String name equal to Shishira Bhatt. String, am I accessing it or did I import and using it? No. Without importing, I can use it. Correct. Actually speaking, I should have imported import java.lang.string. Then I should have accessed it. But with without this also it works. Why? Because the lang is a package, okay, which is present within Java, which can be accessed without importing. This facility is given only for lang package, not for other packages. For example, there is a class called ArrayList, okay, which is present in util package. If you want to use that, you need to import them. ArrayList LST equal to new ArrayList. I'm using a class called ArrayList. So first, you see it's giving you error because you are using it without any import statement. Take the mouse pointer, just say import. Now it is imported, then start using it. Okay, then start using it. So if you want to use file reader, is a class which is present in IO package, and if you want to use this, first import them. File reader fr equal to null. If you want to use this, for example, first import them on mouse, take the mouse pointer on this error message, import them. First import them, then start using it. Okay. They may ask in the interview. It's not that great question, but still possibility. Name few packages that you know in Java. Example, java.lang, java.util, java.io, java.sql, java.regex, java.math, like that, lot many inbuilt or implicit packages are available. Okay, out of that, util package need not to be, lang package need not to be imported. All other packages, if you want to use, you have to import them, then only you can start using it. Okay, so any questions related to packages?
Yeah, okay,
okay, fine.